We're delighted to have Milan Vaishnav with us today. Milan is a senior associate at the South Asia program at the Carnegie Endowment. He has a book coming up in a couple of months called When Crime Pays, Money and Muscle in Indian Politics. So we'll definitely be doing something around that in a few months. Today, Milan's going to be talking to us about when IAS meets big data. Moderating the conversation is our resident senior fellow, Vivek Taheja.
Thanks, Pratika. Milan, I think we'll turn the floor over to you without any further ado, and you're going to get prepared remarks for, what, 30, 35 minutes or so, and then we throw it open to the floor for Q&A?
Sure.
Okay, and if there are any burning questions or clarification, jump in, but if it's a larger discursive point, as if you totally disagree or you wholeheartedly agree with what Milan is saying, save that for the Q&A.
Or just don't say it.
Or don't say it, yeah. So the floor is yours. Welcome, Milan. Great to have you with us here.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you all. It's great to be back at IDFC Institute. I think I was here a year ago, roughly, talking about an entirely different topic. So there is nothing, perhaps nothing, that makes people's eyes glaze over faster in New Delhi than talking about administrative reform. Ruben has assured me that Mumbai is far more intellectual than New Delhi, so I expect that all of you will stay awake for this presentation. This is based on a bunch of kind of new research, a new research initiative on state capacity in India's public sector institutions. And you know what me and a bunch of colleagues are interested in is sort of researching the evolution and performance of Indian public institutions at different levels. And finding new and interesting ways of measuring institutions, of analyzing them and tracking them. And so if anyone's interested, maybe in the Q&A I can tell you about some other stuff that we're doing. And I think it's fair to say, you know, as a sort of conventional wisdom, that in the past quarter century, there have been huge changes on many fronts, right? So if you look at the economy, you look at politics, you look at social change, you look at foreign policy, you know, we could debate to what extent, how far, how fast changes have gone, but obviously there have been huge changes. The one place where we haven't really seen, I think it's fair to say, a lot of change is when it comes to public sector institutions, right? There's a sense of, you know, sort of institutional stagnation. Some would say there's been institutional sort of decay. And I think, you know, the chart that has gotten a lot of attention the past 12 months is this chart from the chief economic advisor, Arvind Subramaniam, in the last economic survey, which shows, you know, economic development on the y-axis and the level of democracy on the right. And, you know, there is this association, right, made famous by lots of people, including Acemoglu and Robinson, where you have, you know, sort of a third of humanity that's sort of these outliers, right? And Arvind's argument is, you know, India is very democratic, but because of sort of weak institutions, poor state capacity, it's way underperforming where it should in economic developmental terms. And China, on the converse, right, has done very well economically, of course, is not democratic, but has a quote unquote sort of strong state, right? So that's sort of the stylized set of facts. Now, one of the recurring subjects when you dig into sort of this institutional stagnation is the subject of civil service reform, specifically the Indian Administrative Service. And you know, I think it's fair to say that whenever we talk about administrative reform, the IAS just sucks up a lot of oxygen, right? We sort of are obsessive about, you know, its faults and its and some of the good things it does. And you know, I think it's a fair statement to say that, you know, fixing whatever is wrong with the IAS is certainly not sufficient to improve governance outcomes, but you know, arguably it's necessary given that it sits at the nerve center of the Indian state. If you think about the most important positions going from local government all the way to the center, right, the IAS sort of constitutes, you know, the nerve center of the Indian state. Now, in thinking about the IAS as part of or emblematic of Indian public sector institutions, a colleague, Saksham Khosla, I should mention this is all joint work with Saksham Khosla, who is a colleague who works at Carnegie in New Delhi, we stumbled across several studies which use quote-unquote big data to study IAS performance. And I put big data in quotes because this is not big data, probably according to sort of the technical definition of big data. What these six studies we found sort of have in common is that they use sort of three types of data that's sort of the most detailed we've seen of three different dimensions. So one is detailed data on the career profiles and sort of trajectory of or mobility of IAS officers. That's number one. Number two is sort of detailed data of a variety of sources. So census, surveys, satellite nightlights data, right, which is increasingly being used to kind of measure as a proxy for economic performance, sort of this new data, highly granular on development outcomes, and then sort of political electoral dynamics, which is, you know, data from the Election Commission. And these six studies sort of coalesce around three questions. So question number one is, what determines career success in the IAS? Success here is defined in multiple ways. Some define it as, you know, moving up the ranks. So, you know, career sort of trajectory from your earliest position to eventually, you know, secretary, cap secretary. To what extent do officers actually influence particular developmental outcomes, and can you sort of quantify that? And the third is, you know, what impact politics has, and what's the sort of dynamic between politicians, politics, elections, electoral competition, and sort of bureaucratic functioning, right, day to day. And we've taken what I call a clinical approach, which I think is going to be disappointing to a lot of people in this room, because we cannot, through this literature, address existential questions about the IAS. You know, I mean, I think if I took a poll, I think many people in this room would say, you know, is abolishing the IAS potentially one outcome we could look at? I can't say anything about that. What we can do is try to provide some analytic leverage over these three questions. And again, this is a sort of synthesis study, right? Trying to pull together what others have done and then try to figure out what are the common takeaways, both when it comes to potential policy reforms which could be implemented, which would reform the workings of the IAS, and number two, ideas for research that could be undertaken by, I don't know, say IDFC Institute on administrative reform. So some very quick context, it's probably not needed for a group like this, but obviously the IAS sort of has very deep colonial roots going back to the Indian Civil Service, created by the Government of India Act of 1858, but at its peak it was pretty small, right? I mean, you could see of over a million officials in 1931, it only had about 1,000 sort of officers, but obviously had an incredible amount of power. And despite sort of the imperial taint of being, you know, a service of the British Raj, the leadership of the Congress Party retained many elements of the basic structure of the ICS when it became the IAS of the newly independent India, for I think at least three reasons, right? So one is we're embarking on this unprecedented experiment, right, of full-fledged democracy at such a low level of per capita income. How could we possibly risk administrative disruption at this precarious time of partition and independence? So therefore, better to sort of stick with the basic structure and then sort of modify, adjust over time as we go. The second is, over time, there was built up a sort of elite esprit de corps, right? This idea that this was a prestigious post, used to pay quite well during the British Raj days, used to attract sort of quite a lot of talent. And so there's actually some sort of hardware that we can work with here, and that there is some kind of ingrained sense of independence and partiality. So even though you change the master at the top from the British Raj to the independent government, that the bureaucracy will sort of follow the lead of the new democratic master, right? So these were many of the arguments people like Vallabhbhai Patel and others made in making the case for why one would need the IAS. Now, the IS is governed by several rules of the road that are common to a lot of kind of Mandarin-type public bureaucracies, right? So one that's specific to India is this idea of dual control, right? So officers belong to state cadres, they split their careers, you know, half between the states, then within the center, and there's some, especially particularly early on in their career, some sort of going back and forth between the two, but they're rooted in state cadres, and they are not only people from those states, but obviously you can be part of any state cadre and be from an entirely different part of the country, which was seen as intrinsic to the architecture, because there was worry about elite capture, and if you had only the Tamilians serving in Tamil Nadu, that would be bad for national unity and also feed a sense of kind of parochialism within the civil service, right? So they wanted to have this kind of melange of different provincial and state views and heritages. The second is, you know, meritocratic recruitment via a competitive exam, a highly competitive exam, right? So the statistics on the likelihood of making it to the creme de la creme are scary, right? Like scarier than getting into Harvard, scarier than getting into sort of IIT, and that's true even today. And it's governed by a pretty specific, rigid set of allocation and assignment procedures, which are sort of codified in government circulars and norms, and then sort of pretty predictable long-term career incentives that are built around this idea of seniority, right? There is pretty, and I'll show you a picture in a bit, the seniority norms which exist on paper and what you actually see in practice, there is a very high correlation. So it's very hard, if you're not at the right rank or right level, to be able to qualify for a senior level position, because you have to sort of wait your turn until you mature. So what plagues the IAS? Like, why is this even, you know, why are we talking about this? So I think there are a couple of things that many studies, which I should mention, many studies which are written by IAS officers, point out. So one is questions about the quality of recruitment and human capital that exists in the IAS today, right? So if you look at the data, this is a paper done by K.P. Krishnan, who probably many of you know, who's just made secretary to the government, and T.V. Somanathan, who is a joint secretary in the Prime Minister's office, have done a very interesting paper on the sort of human capital end of the IAS, and they find that IAS entrants are older, they tend to be less educated than they used to be, and it's taking more attempts to actually clear the IAS entry exam, and they say these are sort of proxies perhaps of the fact that we're not getting the same quality of people, that there are a lot of young people who are spending their youth trying to game the exam, and then they get in, but they're not actually sort of the best qualified. The second is questions about the independence of people who serve in the service. There was a survey done, I think, by UPSC, or the Department of Personnel and Training, in 2010, where 24% of civil servants felt that sought-after posts were based on merit, right? So the large majority thought that, you know, sort of merit is a small factor to sort of determining whether or not I'm going to get a position of real consequence. And then weak public service incentives for advancement. So there is a bias, as I mentioned, towards seniority, a lot of opacity regarding the empanelment process, or the process by which IAS officers become secretaries. It's not always clear to people why some people make it and some people don't. And this is the chart I referenced before. So this is from a study by Marion Bertrand at the University of Chicago and a bunch of co-authors. It's one of the six studies that I'll get into. And this is sort of the years into an IAS officer's tenure and the average pay scale, which is sort of a proxy for, you know, moving up the chain. The dotted line is sort of what the norms say should happen, and the black line is what actually happens, and you can see that they sort of track each other sort of pretty well. You know, there's obvious sort of delays and other things that contribute to this not totally working, but it's a pretty strong correlation, right? The seniority norms are pretty well entrenched. Lack of specialization is another thing that people have claimed that plagues the IAS. So you have the sort of generalist service where you don't necessarily have people who have very specialized sectoral expertise at a time when, you know, India is facing a number of very complicated policy questions, right? So you need people with financial regulatory expertise, social sector expertise, expertise when it comes to managing implementation of particular kinds of infrastructure projects, and we don't really train for that or select for that. And then malfeasance and corruption concerns, which are somewhat hard to quantify, but in the same survey I mentioned before, that 3/4 of officers believe that some or most officers use quote-unquote influence, right, which can mean lots of things, to secure coveted posts, right? So many officers themselves believe that there is a certain amount of underhandedness, shall we say, in determining how some posts get allocated. All right, so that's the sort of motivation, a bit of the context about sort of the past, the present, what ails the IAS. Now I want to get into the 3 questions that I laid out and sort of what the literature says first about what determines career success in the IAS. This study by Bertrand and all that I mentioned, so they take all of the career profiles and information about the academic qualifications, performance of officers, how well they did during their 2-year probationer period, you know, training before they formally start serving in the districts, and they found that for early career positions, civil service entrance examination scores, education, quality of education, and the training they exhibited, the improvement that they exhibited during the training of the first 2 years is highly correlated with success. Now, success means 2 things here. So one is how well they can sort of achieving sort of quality positions. But the second is they've done this 360-degree examination of officers where they take surveys of people who are serving around officers. So they could be politicians, journalists, private sector, civil society. They have 5 or 6 different catchment groups. And then they survey and ask people, can you rate the quality of this particular officer who's serving in your district on the basis of criteria of, you know, being corrupt, being responsive, being somebody who is in touch with their local communities, and so on and so forth. Over time, so as officers progress, those that are older, who begin the service at an older age and who are part of larger cohorts, tend to perform much worse in comparison to others. So 2 charts I'm going to show you from this study. So this is the age at entry and the share of retired officers who are reaching particular pay scales. So here, if you take the dark black line, it's the chief secretary grade, and you can see that the older you are when you enter the service, the less likely you are, because you're going to hit retirement age, right, before you can probably get any of those positions, right? And so there are real barriers to sort of moving up through the service, and this is really seen when you have large cohorts. So this is, if you disaggregate that and look at sort of all cohorts and those who come as part of large cohorts, right, that goes down, that there's this big disjuncture between the two.
Previously,
yeah.
What do you think is the difference between principal sec and chief sec? Because that's a pretty significant difference.
Yeah, I mean, it could just be that that there are more officers who are still able to qualify for those positions, perhaps, but at the age of entry. But by the time you're available for chief secretary, you may have sort of exceeded the retirement age, right? That's one possibility. In the long term, they found clear rewards for investment in training and specialization, but for different reasons. So in the early career, people who had specialized expertise were rewarded with positions in the central government, but they were not placed in areas where they had any specialty expertise. So if you had developed a kind of finance background as a junior officer, That doesn't necessarily mean that you'll get a finance job when you move to the center. It means you'll be picked for a job in the center, but doesn't mean that you'll get something in your sector. Now, late career, that actually changes. So people who have specialized expertise are actually rewarded on the basis of the skills they've accumulated, right? So if you had a finance background, there's a greater likelihood that you're going to be put in a financial post, right? So a lot of people make the case that specialization isn't actually rewarded, which doesn't seem to be true. There's a secondary question of whether or not IS offices are allowed to specialize enough, which is maybe something we want to get into during the discussion. But it does seem that actually, for slightly different reasons, at the early career and late career stage, specialization does seem to be rewarded, although for different reasons. So that's what the studies tell us about the sort of career mobility, career effectiveness, success, rather, of IS officers. The second question, in some ways I think a kind of more interesting question, is what effect do individual officers actually have on outcomes that we care about, right? So developmental outcomes, poverty, governance, and can you actually sort of quantify those? And there are a couple of studies that have tried to do that, and by and large they actually find that, you know, you can measure and quantify the direct impact that individual bureaucrats have on a range of outcomes that we think are things that officers should care about, right? Health, education, poverty outcomes. So the effectiveness of bureaucrats, so what is effectiveness? So effectiveness is people who are judged to be effective by, this is this 360-degree survey, and the background characteristics associated with doing well in the service are correlated with higher growth, especially higher industrial growth, right? So that's one finding which comes out of the Bertrand study. They're also linked to higher revenue, especially non-tax revenue, which is interesting. So this could be either revenue which is coming from public sector units, it could be, you know, grants, obtaining more grants from the center, but that there seems to be this association there where, you know, good officers actually can sort of make a difference, and you can sort of measure that using, this is just, you know, government data. This doesn't involve anything particularly fancy, right? We're talking about growth, revenue. I mean, these are sort of basic economic indicators.
A quick question.
Yeah.
And does this is from also from Bertrand, the final bit? And do they do the obvious? I'm sure they do the obvious controls so that we have some sense this might be a causal relationship as opposed to be a relation just showing up in the data or something spurious going on.
Correct. Yeah, they do. This study here, which is a study by Rikhil Bhavnani and Alexander Lee, actually has an instrumental variables approach. So they're interested in this question of, you know, I mentioned before, there was a decision taken early on that one should be careful about relying on officers serving in states that are their home states because you want to create this culture of national integration. But there's a debate in the development literature about social embeddedness, right? So there's a big argument out there which says, actually, it's pretty good to be very close to where you're from because you're sort of socially embedded, it's easier for you to operate, you may have special skills, say language, cultural knowledge, and so on and so forth, you know how to maneuver. What the Congress leadership was worried about is elite capture, right? So if Rubin were to serve in Kerala, I mean, poor Rubin might be involved in some shady dealings with the Kerala government, which could be true also for entirely different reasons. This, you know, there's this sort of outstanding debate with people sort of arguing both sides. What this Bhavnani and Lee study found is actually there do seem to be benefits. I mean, it's one study, so I think, you know, I would take this with a grain of salt. Where those areas where you have a greater share of quote-unquote local officers, right, so these are officers from the states in which they're serving, are linked to better public goods provision outcomes. So the outcomes that they look at are access to sort of primary basic health facilities and education facilities. The idea that if you look at the change over time, there, local officers seem to be doing better in terms of increasing access, right? Which I guess is a proxy for them being able to get stuff done.
Sorry, another question.
Yep.
So this is local as in they're actually from there as opposed to they're from that state cadre. Right,
no, this is from the state cadre.
So
this
not necessarily
from the local district.
Gotcha.
No, right, exactly.
Or even from the state necessarily.
No, sorry. This is people who are from the state.
They're from the state.
And they're serving in the state cadre.
From the state, serving the state cadre.
Gotcha, so it's both. They're from state X and they're serving.
Correct. That's right. They don't find any benefits, so they look at four different indicators, two health and education I mentioned. They don't find any effects, what roads, access to sort of telecommunications, which are two other things that you could look at from the census. And the argument is, well, maybe, you know, these are things that they don't have a lot of control over because those are run by sort of parastatals. I mean, again, I think this is something where we sort of need a lot more research on. But what's interesting is the benefits you get from local, having more local bureaucrats, that's what the y-axis here is. This is for, the x-axis here is the proportion of population that's literate, and this is an, a measure of newspaper circulation, tends to be in those places where you have you do very well on both of those things. And so their argument is, localness in and of itself may not be such an advantage, and there could be perhaps elite capture where accountability mechanisms aren't working. But where, say, you have a better information environment, you have greater literacy, there's more awareness, you actually can take the same raw material and produce a better outcome because the accountability dynamics are much different in those areas, right? So this is the same measure on the y-axis, just looking at literacy and looking at newspaper circulation. You can see there's sort of this positive relationship in both, where the farther, the better educated, the better the information environment is, the more bang you get from a greater number of local officers. There's a final study, which is sort of a work in progress, from Gautam Rao at Harvard at the Economics Department and a bunch of co-authors, where they use a very different methodology, which comes from the education literature. So this is a value-added methodology that's been typically used to try to estimate the effectiveness or the impact, say, teachers have on learning outcomes. And they use that modeling framework to try to figure out the effect that particular district magistrates, district collectors have on development outcomes. And what they find is that an individual IS officer can explain up to 2% of the variation in investment project outcomes. So they take very detailed information on CapEx projects that's collected by CMIE, and looking at whether or not you actually get a project sort of off the ground towards completion. And they find that, you know, officers actually can affect that. And the fact that officers are moving around means you can actually sort of track an individual officer over time to see what his or her linkage is to investment projects. They also find a slightly smaller effect when it comes to nighttime luminosity, right? So this is electrification, which is, just, again, could be a proxy for just sort of economic activity. So there's a sort of question that's out there about, you know, how much is your babu worth, right? It turns out that your babu could potentially be worth, you know, quite a lot. And the correlates of better performing babus, of officers who are able to actually, are in places where you're seeing better investment outcomes, better light intensity, there are some correlates. So education is one. Language skills, which it gets back to perhaps this idea of embeddedness. So if you have very strong Bengali skills and you're able to operate in Bengal, that actually could be a potential advantage over someone else who, for whom Bengali is not a mother tongue. And direct recruits do much better. So the IS is comprised of people who come directly through the UPSC system and those who come through the state cadres, right, who sort of gain entry into the IAS, and they find that there is a difference between the direct recruits and those who come from the service. So these are things that are correlated with better performance. The final question that this literature tells us about is relates to politics and what the impact of politics is on bureaucratic performance. So I think it's well known, you know, this sort of system which exists today of the so-called transferage, right? That there's this sort of bureaucratic merry-go-round that officers are locked onto, and that politicians often, for whimsical or idiosyncratic, potentially politically motivated reasons, move them around at will. This is a study by Lakshmi Iyer and Anand Limani. This is a chart which looks at how, this is from one state, from Tamil Nadu, how transfers fluctuate according to sort of elections, right? And you can sort of see here that virtually all of the peaks, that's what the purple lines are sort of happening in elections, right? So you get Jay Lalata, she kicks everyone out, brings a bunch of new people, and get Karunanidhi, same thing happens, and it sort of happens kind of, you know, over and over and over again. And this is, stepping back and looking at the entire country as a whole, the probability that you're going to get transferred sort of the months before and after a new chief minister sort of comes to office. Now, I should just say there could be good reasons for this. It's not necessarily the case that sort of all transfers are bad, right? I mean, if you're a leader and you have an established working relationship with a bureaucrat, you may want him or her to sort of serve with you in a key post, right? But I think most people believe, anecdotally again, that those positions are perhaps in the minority, that oftentimes these are people who have sort of a kind of political loyalty and are not necessarily the best quality officers for the job. But again, that's an empirical question that this data isn't necessarily able to address. What they find is that the average tenure of an IS officer in any given post is around 16 months, but there's a lot of variation, right? So in UP, that's 6 months, despite the fact that there are norms about how long officers should be in particular positions. And that the probability of transfer in any given year is really high, right? So it's above 50%, and that increases significantly when you have a new chief minister sort of in power, which is what those charts suggested. What they are able to tell from the data that they have is it's clear that there is some inefficiency going on by this political transfer, right? So if you look at quote-unquote good officers based on their sort of training, skills, expertise, they're not always occupying sort of most critical posts, right? So if you believe the literature that I showed you before, that there are a lot of these indicators we have in officers that are highly predictive of how good or bad they are, there seems to be a mismatch here in some cases, and that political loyalty often does present an alternative route to success. So they looked at two states, UP and Uttarakhand, where they had data on the caste profiles of officers, and looked at whether or not the fluctuation, this transferage, correlated at all with changes in the caste profile of the chief minister and his or her party's sort of core base, right? And they find quite a lot of that in those two Hindi belt states. They have some preliminary evidence, and they themselves say it's very preliminary, and it's just a correlation that in places where you have more transfers going on, so a higher transfer intensity, there's some evidence to suggest that developmentally there's some negative ramifications. So in their case, they look at poverty and find that poverty is actually, reduction is lower, although they say nothing about sort of the causal direction of that relationship. I think it's important to point out, before we demonize sort of politics too bad, that politics works in funny ways, and sometimes in somewhat counterintuitive ways. Some of you may be familiar with Anusha Nath, who's an economist who's presented at IDFC before, who has this interesting study where she concludes that actually political stability, so where you don't have very high political competition, can lead to better bureaucratic performance. So the standard way we think about this is political competition is sort of healthy, right? Because it's going to keep people in check, and if you have one person around for too long, there may be some kind of collusion or sort of negative performance. So what she looks at is, you know, the MP LADS scheme, so the Member of Parliament Local Area Development Scheme, right? Every MP is given a certain pot of money to invest in constituency development projects, and the MPs are able to recommend projects, but it's really the district magistrate and the district machinery that's in charge of implementing those local development projects. And she has project level data on the sort of recommendation and then the actual implementation of those projects. And she takes advantage of two quirks in the Indian electoral system. So one is the fact that you have reservations. So when you had delimitation in 2007, where some seats became that were reserved for scheduled castes or scheduled tribes became unreserved in open general constituencies, which means that it's likely that the incumbent is not going to be the incumbent anymore because he doesn't belong, he's not a Dalit or an Adivasi, or vice versa. And split districts, so these are districts where, you know, there's no alignment between administrative boundaries and political boundaries. So there are districts which often have multiple MPs who have parts of that district. So she uses that to try to tease out the relationships that are going on. So what she finds is that where incumbents can't rerun due to reservation, the delays in sanctioning new projects actually rises pretty significantly by 13%. So if you think this seat has become reserved for an SC and this person is not an SC, so she can't stand any longer, so I'm just going to outlast her. You know, I don't necessarily have to do what she says. There's not going to be any fallout from that because she's going to be gone in the next election by default. And that's, in fact, sort of what she finds. And in places that are party strongholds, so where you have a distinct hold of a particular party and a record of winning those places consistently, you find that the district administration actually is approving projects at a much faster rate on average, right? So the idea is, if the incumbent is actually known and competition is less, then you're actually getting better project outcomes, which is, I think, somewhat counterintuitive, because you know, there's clearly some amount of calculation perhaps going on. That's her argument. That the district collector is doing vis-a-vis who the politician is. And this effect of incumbency is much more pronounced when the officer is up for promotion to a new pay grade, right? So there's a sort of interaction that's going on between those two things. So just to sum up on those three things, there is a lot of data which is out there which is predictive or highly associated with career success, as well as success as measured objectively by, or subjectively by people in the ecosystem of IS officers. There seems to be some nascent evidence which suggests that individual officers can have statistically significant impacts on policy developmental outcomes that we care about. And again, we sort of know what the correlates of that are. And there is this highly negative effect most of the time that politics seems to be having because of the process of transfers on bureaucratic functioning, although, you know, it's tricky, right? Politics cuts often in unexpected ways, as Anusha's paper shows. So what does this mean? So part of the objective of this paper, you know, is essentially to do this, to just say this is a lit review of sort of what we know and where do we go from here. But I do think that if you take all of these takeaways, there's sort of two sets of issues that become clear. So one is there are particular policy proposals that many of these studies point towards. So one is, you know, how can we find ways of resuscitating ideas that have been out there of thwarting political interference in the bureaucracy, right? So somehow bringing the relationship between politicians and bureaucrats into maybe a more positive sort of equilibrium. So there have been calls There have been Supreme Court judgments around central and state governments moving on civil service protection, so creating civil service boards that would create a more transparent process, and that if there were transfers to be had, there'd be some process of kind of rule of law, of appeals, of transparency, and so on and so forth. Very, very few states, despite prodding from the Supreme Court, have actually moved on civil service boards. Many politicians don't like civil service boards because they say, you know, quite rightly, that, you know, maybe there are times when it's actually good to transfer people, and that some amount of discretion is actually warranted. So one compromise, which has been mooted in many government reports, is this idea of a stability index. So for particularly important positions, you might say, on average, over some time horizon, officers who hold this position should serve 2 years or 3 years. Now that means you might transfer somebody after 6 months, but on average over the medium term, people should serve around 2 years. So it's sort of a target that you try to work around, right? And that the civil service board that's mediating the relationship between bureaucrat and politician would be entrusted and charged with upholding. So that's sort of one sort of policy takeaway that comes out of this. The second is, how do you think about creating the right career incentives for IAS officers? So, you know, one idea is, do we need to get away from sort of IAS dominance? Because there are areas of specialized expertise which are in many other services, right? The Indian Economic Service, the Indian Revenue Service, the Indian Police Service. But there also are, you know, ways of creating more competition that go beyond seniority norms, right? So you may have a mid-career officer who is an expert on telecommunications regulation, but is never going to get that post because he or she is not yet, you know, an additional secretary or a secretary. So, you know, this often gets talked about in the context of lateral entry. And I think what's very interesting is when you talk to IAS officers, many of them actually, and this was somewhat something I found surprising, back lateral entry. But they define lateral entry in a very different way than the way we usually talk about it. So lateral entry usually means, you know, bringing someone in from the private sector, bringing in someone from a think tank, bringing in someone from a university. But their idea is that, you know, maybe there should be opening to other services as well as within the service, so that the IAS officers actually could benefit the most from so-called lateral entry, although it's not really lateral anymore if you're allowing junior positions, junior people to compete for quote-unquote senior posts. But there is actually some ways in which I think this can be spun that some officers could actually get behind. The other thing that these studies seem to show is that it might be worth thinking about going back to a reduced eligibility age for IAS officers, right? Given that there seem to be negative consequences of officers who are older and come from larger cohorts. So the other policy idea which has been out there is that maybe we should reduce the number of positions so that the Indian Administrative Service looks more like a pyramid than a sort of cylinder, right?
Let me ask you a question on the age thing. So they have actually moved on this. So
this government has.
This government has moved on it, and there's younger joint secretaries who've been empaneled.
Yeah.
The problem is you still are dealing with an internal caste system, right? So a younger joint secretary against an older joint secretary, there's still a hierarchy between those two. So how do you sort, you know, solve for that problem? So technically, from a position standpoint, you solve the problem. But there's still an internal problem to solve for, which is, you know, this person is also a joint sec, but he's, whatever, 10 years older than me.
Right. Because you're saying that person won't get the respect he or she deserves,
right?
Because he's not
because
an additional secretary.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Not additional secretary. Joint secretary,
right.
Both of them are the same rank, but different age.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, there's no silver bullet, right? I mean, I think it's a normative cultural shift within the service that needs to take part, right? I mean, it's the same idea of you know, one of the things I wanted to talk about is, you know, creating an up and out system, right? So this government has forcibly retired a small number of officers who have been deemed unfit to continue, right? Which could be more institutionalized, but obviously there's tremendous pushback against that, right? But that's essentially the system that the military has, right? I mean, it's sort of an up and out system. So if you don't make a particular rank, then you have nowhere to go. And so the only place to go is the exit, right? And that's another thing that one has to think about. Now, the pushback is, well, that's going to ruin career incentives, right? Because people are doing this because they think there's some stability of tenure, right? So there is a bit of a, it's hard to see how you can have your cake and eat it too, right? I mean, this is eventually about making hard choices, right? You know, one thing I think that's interesting to think about, and maybe this group could, we could brainstorm a little bit during the discussion, is how do you actually use the data that's out there? So both the data that's collected by the civil services, right, or by DOPT and UPSC, as well as all kinds of big, you know, in quotes, data that's out there, to both make decisions about where officers should go. So do you want to take the best officers and put them in the hardest places where they have the hardest problems, right? That's one way you could think about it. Making more fine-grained decisions that link specialization to particular positions. But also, how do you use these metrics as part of a system evaluation, right? So I think it would probably be a step too far to say you want to make all of these data, all of these decisions completely data-based, because there needs to be probably some level of discretion you want to use. And frankly, officers do lots of things. Development is only one of them, right? All of these results are basically development outcomes, but there are lots of other things that officers have to do when they're serving. But I do think it's something worth thinking about, that are we basically throwing away a lot of information that we have collected by the government, independent of the government, you know, in thinking about these two things? And I mentioned this again, thinking about an up and out system. The third sort of recommendation or point of debate is this idea of allocating officers to home states. And, you know, I mean, this is something which I think is very controversial and sort of somewhat sensitive, because it does cut against the ideas that Patel and others had about, you know, integrating the polity by sort of taking people from states that they were from and putting them elsewhere. And so one might not want to sort of move on this on the basis of, you know, one or two studies, but is there room for experimentation? I mean, could we actually do this with some state cadres and see whether or not it has an impact? And I'd be curious if any of you have ideas about whether or not you could do that and whether it'd be wise to do that. But there's some people who say that, you know, we're now at a stage in Indian development where we're not as concerned as we once were about these ideas of national integration. We have problems, but, you know, we are willing, you know, maybe this is time to kind of revisit this. So I think that's a question for discussion. I'll just end here. This is my last slide on thinking about sort of future research, and this is a very incomplete list, but a couple of questions which have jumped out for me. I mean, clearly, we need more data on performance, right? I mean, there are, you know, six studies, only a couple of which have actually looked at this relationship. There's a lot more work to be done thinking about the effect IS officers can have and how that can be, you know, form the basis of some kind of evaluative criteria. And I think, particularly on this insider versus outsider debate, is something that, you know, I think is worth kind of digging into a little bit more. Efficiency at senior level. So a lot of these studies are focused very much on district level outcomes, because that's what we can measure very well, right? But that is referring to officers when they're in a pretty early stage of their career, right? So when they may be collectors who are actually sort of the kingpins in a particular district. But how do you measure efficiency or effectiveness at higher levels in the government, sort of using data, right? I mean, I don't have a clear sense of how one does that. I imagine it's going to vary a lot depending on what the position is and what the sector is. But that's a little bit of a black box. If you take a more data-based approach, it's easier to do when the person is sort of serving at the state level where we have that kind of granularity of data. It becomes much more complicated as you sort of move up the system. One thing that has gotten a lot of airtime in the op-ed pages is the sort of post-retirement careers of IS officers, right? And the extent to which they've sort of monopolized positions of tribunals and of various government agencies, commissions, so on and so forth, and whether or not India's kind of turned into a sinecure state, right, where sort of people are looking for these golden parachutes, and that then changes their incentives as officers. So if you know that there may be some plum post-retirement post out there, is that actually affecting the way in which you behave when you're in office? Either to behave in a politically inclined way or just not to take any decisions at all because you don't want to risk the fact that you may have some lucrative sort of post-service career. And here, as far as I know, there's zero sort of data on what happens to IS officers after they leave the service. And I think just as an interesting data gathering exercise, it would be neat to sort of, you know, do a survey of sort of recent retirees and sort of figure out, you know, can we sort of track this sort of over time. So there's a lot of literature from the United States, for instance, on what happens to congressional staffers after they work on the Hill, right? What opportunities are there for them post office? And this is a sort of idea of there's, you know, a revolving door and that you can actually measure some of this. We have no idea. The last thing, and this is something that you know is not a novel thought by any stretch, but we know absolutely nothing about state level bureaucracies yet. In some ways, you know, they are just as important, if not more important, than everything we've been talking about. And I think a lot of us have these sort of gut senses that there are particular states where bureaucracies work better than others. But it's very impressionistic, right? It's completely anecdotal, and almost nobody I know who sort of studies and tries to kind of measure state-level bureaucracies. And I think that's something, again, where a kind of comparative study, even just qualitatively, would you know, start to create a research agenda for how we should think about, you know, states, which are, you know, becoming ever more increasing sort of instruments of governance. Thanks very much. If any of you have questions or comments that you can't bring up here, please send them to Ruben, send them to me, and look forward to the discussion. Thanks.
Thank you, really.
Quick comment.
I was about to say the floor is open. If you could just tell us your name, but not everyone knows each other around this table.
I'm Sandeep Parekh from FinCEN Law Advisors, and I've been part of public sector for a short while. And I'm one of the lateral entries. So I want to make a point on this whole business of data and appraisals. And I think there's just so much of noise. Everybody gets between 90 and 95. So what you're looking at is noise and garbage rather than actual data. And there are, of course, lots of incentive structures why people rate everybody between 90 and 95, which makes it very nearly impossible to actually rank people. The second is a very interesting anecdote, which I discovered to my surprise. Mr. Subbarao, before he was governor of RBI, was in the finance ministry. And there are several people from his own batch, and batch apparently in IS is critical. Right. Not just that 10-year difference, but
no, the batch.
Within a batch, you are more senior if you scored 45 years back on a higher rank in that IS exam. So he was designated finance secretary because of a higher rank in that exam 45 years back. So that's the level of complete objectivity and complete stupidity at the same time. So just to short off.
But just to ask to clarify the first question, I mean, that's an argument. So what you're saying is basically everyone is deemed to be doing superbly, right? I mean, they're all at the kind of 95th to 99th percentiles, right? But isn't that an argument for using more objective criteria rather than the current system, which is, you know, the ACRs and everyone sort of saying, you know, good, you know. Was that the point you were making?
ACRs is where the 90 to 95 comes.
Correct, right. So yeah. Moving away from that system to something else is what you're advocating for.
Yeah, but how do you do it? The incentive structure is embedded in the 90 to 95. Even I have a related point.
Yeah.
Just how does somebody's knowledge of, say, English literature influence their performance as, say, a state election commissioner? How does one feel into it? Because what are you testing? What are you calling education? What are you testing when you're taking that IAS entrance exam? So the actual performance is based on other things.
Right. No, I mean, I should just be clear, I'm not testing anything. The great thing about this paper is I can just blame the person who wrote it because I didn't write anything except for the summary. No, I mean, I think the point that comes across in the studies is that there actually seems to be, maybe against our feelings or preconceptions, something contained in the exam information, right? I mean, at least at early stages of people's careers, whatever questions are there on civil service main actually are predictive of how well people do early stages of their career, right? So I guess the point that the authors sort of make is saying there is some information here about the initial distribution of quality. And that data on the initial distribution of quality can feed into thinking about how we assign people to certain posts rather than sort of what happens, which is a kind of random assignment, right? It's sort of where people get allocated early on their careers. And so I think that's a sort of limited contention. I think there's no one, and again, I should just emphasize that the studies that talk about the effectiveness of the exam scores tend to be looking at early stage stuff. So the 45-year example, right, I don't think they would even claim that, you know, that predicts something that far into the future. But it does seem to be associated with, quote unquote, better performance early on.
Ramesh, go ahead.
Yeah. So here in the ranks, basically the kind of attention that people get and the kind of posting that they get are also dependent on the scores that they get. And that helps them a lot in terms of improving performance in the early stage. So more than the test, basically the outcome gets you opportunities which help you to perform much better also.
Sorry, just repeat that again.
Based on your scores, basically, the postings that you get and the kind of exposure that you get or attention that you get changes. If you have a higher rank, you get more attention from politicians or bureaucrats, and the kind of posting that you get also changes, which helps you to perform much better in the early stages of your career.
Right. I mean, so you're saying that there is some level of de facto signaling that goes on based on how well you do, even if it's not necessarily sort of codified,
right.
Yeah. I mean, there are these norms in several states, which I learned from talking to officers I hadn't realized that, you know, so in Tamil Nadu, for instance, the topper gets, you know, there's a special position that person always goes to, same in Bengal, for instance, were two examples that people sort of mentioned, which goes along with sort of what you're saying, right?
We had a question here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anup, yes, human strength.
We're all some degree of that.
Yeah, so just to get a sense of that big black box you talked of at the state level, huge bureaucracy. I don't know if I missed the number, but you said 1858, when 1,000 odd IS officers were allocated, the size of the bureaucracy was about 1 million. Do we have data to say today, what is the ratio? How many IS officers do? What's the size of bureaucracy that you're dealing with?
So it's 4,000 officers, IS officers.
Right.
The size of the government.
Well, there are 3 million people who are central government employees, the government of India, and there's, I think, 16, 17 million total government employees at center, state, local.
In 1931, it's 1,000 out of 1 million. Now it's 4,000 out of 16.
Yeah, and that's really my second question, because that big black box that you pointed to is really big.
Yeah.
And it has a huge impact on the ability of the IS officers to implement, which is where we're trying to scorecard them. So my question really is, and pondering about it, is what is it that we're going to do at that level that will really help the IS officers be more effective? Average tenure of prescribed 16 months, which is much lesser in many cases. You have huge bureaucratic engines which are really not willing to move. So it's a tough bind.
Yeah.
It's a tough line. So it seems like, while it's contra-intuitive, the whole political aspect of what you mentioned, if you have a strong political regime, which has a strong mandate, seems like it's not contra-intuitive. That's the only way really some change can happen.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to see what are the levers. Mm-hmm. A short tenured IS officer, a junior ranking, given a large size portfolio. Do we have a sense of what's the size of, let's say, a district portfolio, just to get a sense in terms of revenue or sizes? Is there a range?
Yeah.
We have 675 districts. I'm assuming it'll be a huge range.
Yeah.
But it's a reasonable size responsibility.
Yeah.
And so that's really my big, you know, question. And
yeah, I mean, it
seems,
yeah.
Yeah.
No, thanks. Super. I mean, I think that, I mean, in the process of doing something else, another piece of research, there's actually no one number of districts that the government of India agrees on.
Really?
Yes.
It's
true.
Like,
yes.
675.
Is a number that is true according to one government agency, but another government agency says there's 693 districts. And another that says there's 664.
So now with the new Telangana.
Another 31, yeah. I mean, so, I mean, that's the level at which we're working is, you know, we can't even agree amongst, you know, core federal agencies how many districts are there in this country. I don't know if, Jessica, you have an answer to this.
I was just going
to
add more anecdotes that are similar.
Yeah. So the second is, so, Yamini Iyer, who is at the runs the Accountability Initiative Center for Policy Research, a friend of Ruben's. What I've after, you know, getting to be a friend of Ruben's for many years, there's different circles. So I'm a good friend. Yamini is a dear friend. Then there's a close friend. Then there's a best friend. And there's the oldest friend. So I'm sort of like seven. I'm like a district magistrate. And Yamini is like ma'am. She's like a cab sec.
You're
so
entry level.
Yeah.
I'm still waiting to write the exam.
That's right. So she is trying to do just this. We don't even know how many schemes a district collector oversees. There's no number. Like, we know it's a big number, but we have zero idea, like we have no method, or even sort of time use. So if you were to take the hours in the day that a DM works, for instance, or a BDO works, I mean, how do they allocate their time, right? So what percentage of their time is actually managing these schemes versus dealing with people who just show up in their office who have some issue about a BPL card or a pension or a ration or whatever, versus politicians who are calling them, you know, or contractors who have some issue of non-payment or interference or, you know. So, I mean, when I said the black box, I mean, it's not just the state bureaucracies and the state cadre, civil services, but it's also, you know, what's actually happening with even the IS officers on a day-to-day basis. I mean, I think the problem with studying state civil services is sort of obvious, which is just, it's a data gathering problem, right? So if you want to study the IAS, you can go to DOPT and UPSC. And I should mention, all of these studies, it's not like they walked in and these guys gave them data. They had to scrape it off websites, right? I mean, so it was incredibly computationally problematic, but that was the only way to get at this. And I think state services are I would guess, are even worse, right?
Oh, don't mention this.
Yeah.
We have a question on this.
My name is Ashish. I had a little tangential question, saying we are kind of discussing IAS, but how does similar structure in, say, US or China or Russia or UK would be working, and how do they kind of compare in their scope or size or way of doing things or their performance or lack of it, and how do you measure them? Because it seems to be very self-serving, self-centered framework that IAS is. I mean, we have in our own cocoon, we are kind of observing ourselves. What about other guys?
Do you actually want to answer that? You probably have more informed answers than I do. I mean, I think the first thing to note is that, relates to something I was talking to Rajesh about earlier today, is what the state does. I mean, the state just does a hell of a lot more than it does in a lot of other places, right? I mean, sort of the typical American bureaucrat doesn't nearly have the range of functions because a lot of that is happening in the private sector rather than being done by the public sector, right? So that's sort of number one. I think one thing that has increasingly been common in the United States, so I know, for instance, it's done in the Foreign Service, is, you know, 360 degree evaluations. Now, a lot of people roll their eyes when you talk about 360 evaluations because they're incredibly onerous, and, because, you know, they take time, you have to get, but it gives you a much better picture of sort of the performance, right? Is this someone who actually is sort of respected by his or her peers, by his or her subordinates, by people who work not under direct or above supervisory hierarchy, but, you know, who interact in different ways? I mean, so that's sort of one thing, and those things are funneled, and because they're coming from people who aren't directly supervising or below you, but from all over, people are more likely to sort of say things that are actually meaningful rather than just sort of give everyone a sort of, you know, 100 out of 100 or whatever. I mean, I don't know if anybody else has.
Yeah, I just shudder at the prospect of, say, 10-year decisions made on a 360 degree evaluation. None of us would have made it.
Yeah, but that's, yeah. Right. Sure, well, but that's why we don't care about teaching in academia.
Yeah.
Jessica, you had a,
but,
you had
yeah.
your,
but on
your
this
hand.
Point,
yeah.
I mean, there's one other big difference, I think, between the IAS and at least US and some of the European bureaucracies, which is that what comes out of Parliament leaves a lot more questions that would be considered political elsewhere or to be decided through a political process to the bureaucracy. So things like a commission shall be set up and the appropriate commission shall decide XYZ that would ordinarily be framed within the law are put into the executive branch. So that's also, I
so what I heard is, I don't know, I could be completely
mm-hmm.
wrong, is that when US president comes,
it's 4,000 people leave.
Yeah.
Top
yeah.
guys
yeah.
leave and then other guys
yeah.
come in. And for
right.
me, if you have to search, kind of, why do we do research, in my opinion, is to improve, right? And probably the answer might not be also from within, but from without.
Yeah.
And so if we study those guys and say, probably China is doing a good job for 2,000 years, or I don't know, or US is doing a good job, or take a mix and match
yeah.
and kind of improve that, at least 2,000 new guys have to come in at these levels, who knows?
Yeah, so there are about 4,000, I think, political appointees, right, who basically serve at the pleasure of the president, right? So these are people who are picked by, you know, the transition team. So what I'm missing by not being here is this crazy jockeying that's going on in Washington right now about, you know, who's going to get what position, and people who are trying to sort of align themselves for their sort of dream jobs, right? And that's something that happens every 4 years, right? And even though there's, let's see, likely to be a Dem to Dem transition, famous last words, that there's still that, so everybody who is a political appointee under Obama will have to tender his or her resignation and then can be reappointed or not by the new
mm-hmm.
president, and then may be assigned a different position. But that's, you know, obviously a political call that has to take, you know, take place by Parliament here, whether or not they want to grant the executive, you know, that kind of authority to create top line, you know, sort of positions, and what happens in a parliamentary form of government when you don't have fixed terms, right? So you could have an early election, a snap election called, the coalition falls apart, and then you're switching these top guys, you know, every 12 months, or, you know,
that is happening
years.
In IES as per your statistics. 6 months is and
true,
right? So
yeah.
It's not helping either side.
But it would be like mass lateral hiring, which brings up, I mean, the observation I was going to make, actually, I did have a question in addition to observations,
sure.
Is that it seems like a lot of these studies are looking at the data that are observable and that are readily scrapable because
sure.
they're in some ways collected. So it's reform, no, which is,
yeah.
which is all you can do.
Yeah, sure.
But I think if we went back to thinking about how organizations function and why organizations function differently and what is the importance, a lot of it has to do with the social networks within the organization. And it's much more than you know, the ones that were brought up about those who, you know, those who have, you know, higher earlier score or whatever else. And anecdotally, there are three things that have happened a lot that I've seen over the past, you know, 10 to 15 years in my work, which has been a lot of dealing with IAS officers. One is an extraordinary amount of interagency and interpersonal collaboration that's based on, you know, number one, being together at the state level and knowing that you have to coordinate between different agencies that look fragmented. You can never do it publicly, but there's an enormous amount of joint meetings, regular calling, that's completely invisible. The second is people being able to call on people they've served with in past appointments. And so that's one thing you could observe. So if you look at their past few appointments and who their peers were, and what are the influences of that on their ability and their effectiveness, especially if you start to look at state level policy or sectoral policy. The third is patronage and mentorship. So, you know, I can think of several district collectors who are well known to be the mentees of quite a powerful principal secretary in the state government in Tamil Nadu, which is where I live. And also to have patronage from the extended network of this principal secretary who used to work for quite powerful politicians on both sides of the aisle. And it's sort of a known fact that these people, even though they're district collectors, are better able to get things done because they can sort of reach up into the top. And that seems to be something that is reasonably, you know, it's sort of an internal well-known mentorship process. And so if there's a way to figure out how to track those networks and then to look at that, and rather than try to make all the recommend, because I think the danger of going in the recommendations direction with only formal processes is that you might kill all of the discretion that allows for this informal coordination, which is quite effective. Because across a lot of, I mean, it's very, in sociology, there's this whole, that the growth of the gray space is not so bad, that if the black and white is completely dysfunctional, what people come up with as emergent collaboration is often very reasonable, and you don't want to squash it. So in building a research agenda, it seems important to start from first principles mm-hmm. rather than a literature review. Mm-hmm.
And the interesting point to add to that is if you work with government, you realize very quickly that that social network is everything.
Yeah, it is. I mean, and you know what you could do? You could look at weddings.
It is only
no, seriously. No, if you look at wedding invite lists and you see sort of who attends whose daughters and sons, I mean, at least gives you a bit of a practice.
Right. Although in theory, like, I mean, the social networks are in and of themselves neutral, right? It's how they choose to be used,
yeah.
right? I mean, so you could have a social network that's used for precisely the wrong reasons of, I'm the principal secretary's person, and therefore she can call me up whenever I have to do something that you know needs to be done that's not necessarily in the public interest, right?
You could look at it as when does effectiveness, so you could even look at different policy areas. You say, when does effectiveness rely on internal management of the public sector workforce?
Mm-hmm.
So that's one set of issues. Second is, when does effectiveness rely on having a good relationship with the private sector where you need to have informal cover or else you're going to be accused of corruption and all of that. Like, it's a whole different level of diplomacy that you need. Then the third is, when does performance require interagency coordination across or interfederal coordination? And the importance of, you know, your mentorship protection, you would expect to have the strongest effect on the ones that are public-private. The importance of your innate skills, like your management skills, the ones that might be imperfectly tested for by the entrance exam, you'd expect to be highest in the purely internal management part, if the test is reasonable. And then the third one, this kind of interagency network, you could differentiate and you could come up with testable hypotheses
right.
in which at least some of the things you can collect without having to do complete
right.
primary work.
That's great. Did you
but
just come up with this right now?
Yeah. Sorry.
That's like a beautiful 3x3 like matrix. You just
came up with. I did just teach for business school.
Yeah.
We're trained to do that.
Yes, yeah, please.
My name is Nozar Aga. I represent Liberals think tank. Did any study show the correlation with what the IAS is paid and what performance rating? Because generally, a chief secretary is now paid some like 2.5 lakhs. So I think that's a big anomaly, and it may be much better if IAS pay scales are brought into level with the private sector. And the very concept of this IAS has to be rethought, and maybe we should move into a contractual type of system where the efficiency and the performance. See, Sardar Patel in those days, he didn't want to dislodge the system. But I think after so many decades, maybe we need an alternative out-of-the-box thinking.
Yeah. I mean, I think there are three things I would say. One is the pay that officers received during the ICS days was very high.
Yeah.
I mean, senior officers made more than the U.S. Secretary of Treasury, right?
Because I was told they were also given a revenue share.
Yeah, I mean, there was, I mean, some would say they still get a revenue share. The second is, if you look at the various pay commission reports over time, there's very clearly a lot of pay compression that has taken place, right? So like the distance between wages of sort of senior officers and the bottom has gradually narrowed over time. So a lot of people say that you've got to reverse that in order to sort of, you know, kind of...
Yeah, the incentives are for the lower half of government to actually be in government because it's the highest pay they'll ever get.
Right. But the third thing is there is now a literature, some of you may be more familiar than I, about pay for performance, right, in public sector hiring. And there are some interesting findings. I mean, the overall literature is somewhat mixed, but I mean, that's something which a lot of countries are increasingly testing, experimenting with, right? I mean, you have some slab, which is your base wage, and then there's actually a bonus given depending on how sort of well you perform, right? And so that creates some kind of incentive structure to sort of do well, rather than say, I've reached a particular pay scale, and for the next 5 years, no matter what I do, I'm gonna make the same amount of money, whether I'm a great officer, or a moderate officer, or a really bad officer.
Yep,
there,
we're
back.
Abhishek from India's Bank. I want to delve into the thing where the local officer versus the outsider, that thing. So in the last 3 years, I've seen that the local officers seem to performing well in large geographical areas, like the district collectors. And when they are transferred into municipal corporations, it happens that the political influence turns out to be negative, and that officer is transferred more frequently. Now, this is a notional observation, but in the same case, in the municipal corporations or agglomerations, upper agglomerations, and there are outside officers, they perform, their tenure goes around quite without hassles. It has been, I mean, it's been my observation. So, does geography affect this thing, outsider versus local thing, that a local officer performs well in large geographies, and an outsider performs better in compact urban settings?
Yeah. I mean, it's a hypothesis to be tested, and they don't sort of look at that. I mean, I think this is the one finding that gets the most pushback from IS officers. So when I published this paper, the first people I heard from were the officers who are UP officers serving in Andhra, who said this is all wrong because the best officers they know are serving outside of state. So, I mean, the answer is we don't know. I mean, it's quite possible that the effect that you're seeing of locally embedded officers doing better is also contingent. So what they say is it's contingent on the strength of accountability mechanisms, but there could be other factors, right? So is it a conflict-intense area, right? Is there some Naxal violence going on? Is it the example you gave when you work in a municipal corporation versus working in a district functionary, you know, do you get something different? I mean, these are all things to be looked at that no one's looked at, as far as I know. But maybe India Spend wants to look at.
We're coming up towards the end of our official time. I think we can take a few more questions and wrap up in about 5 or 10
minutes.
Just
to add to the point, the local identity also has been called upon quite a bit now. So, for example, the Telangana state, the newly set up, and the chief minister, when he wanted a strong administrative support, called on the CMD of Coal India to come and be a secretary, for example, and he was from the state cadre, etc. So just to kind of, there seems to be that when there is a strong local identity, there is a good mandate, and there is a strong agenda, there is that coming together of force as well at a higher level, not at a lower level,
right,
that perhaps could lead to development in one sense.
Right. That's very interesting.
Patrick.
Hi, Patrick Lamson Hall from New York University. Newly arrived this morning, badly jet lagged. But I did have a question about this elite capture versus social embeddedness issue. It's kind of a two-parter, I guess. First, in the paper that you referenced, did they find that elites actually are capturing in those cases? Like, did they find higher measures of corruption from locally based officers? And then, to kind of tie into this gentleman's comment from a moment ago, what do you think about like higher pay as a mechanism for reducing corruption?
Great cards.
They're very well compensated. Just off balance sheet compensation.
That's what should be avoided.
Yeah.
That's what is the cancer of this country.
No, but the problem, sir, is that you can avoid it, but you have the enforcement mechanism. See, Singapore pays high, but the enforcement mechanism exists.
You should also pay market prices, get the best man for the job.
But if the person still cheats, do you have the enforcement mechanism to go after the person? Singapore does.
Yeah. I mean, I think, so on the first thing, they don't. They don't. I mean, this is, so all they're looking at is the development outcomes that they observe and whether or not those are better or worse, right? But not actually testing for something that's being captured, right? Which would be an obvious kind of next step to look at. I think on the pay for performance thing, yeah, I mean, I sort of agree with Ruben a little bit, which is, or the increased pay. I mean, it depends on enforcement, but then also subjecting individuals associated with the state, which for me also includes politicians, to much greater disclosure sort of norms right now, right? So, I mean, if you take an MP right now, I mean, in the looks of a, there's no publicly disclosed conflict of interest that anyone has to make. So any affiliation someone might have with a private enterprise is submitted privately to the Registrar General of the Lok Sabha, but that's, none of us actually ever get to see that. So similarly, I think if you're going to do that, then you have to create better enforcement, but also just better transparency, right? I mean, it's the sort of debate that we often have about public funding of elections. So should there be more state funding? Perhaps, but there needs to be a grand bargain whereby parties are forced to disclose all of their contributions, including those that are very small. So, because otherwise the alternative is you take the black money and the white money both, and you end up with a much better situation, right, if you're the political actor. So
if we start with state funding, at least we should make a start.
That's a different topic for a different seminar.
I like the point that you made, you know, the emphasis on the IDS moving from a generalist to a specialist, and that will distinguish performance, because today there's so many new ministries and sectors that need that specialization, which is not there. I don't see an IAS officer that has derivative market experience.
The answer to all your problems is T.V. Somanathan. He wrote a book on derivatives.
It's the specialization of the sectors. Telecom is another thing.
Yeah,
I mean, you just don't see, you know, or technology, or, you know, these are new areas that need specialization. And if you have a tenure of 16 months, you will never get specialization in that job either.
Yeah.
But performance will be really mapped well when you see a specialist vis-a-vis a generalist. And I think going forward, that is going to be the distinguishing factor.
I mean, I think there's, there are a couple of policy proposals which are out there, right? So one is, after you reach the sort of JS level, that's when you are tracked into a particular specialization. So you become the securities guy, the derivatives guy, or the telecom guy. And that may mean some particular training that you have to
see,
step
maybe the
outside
finance
your
ministry wasn't a good example to use, but if you look at the urban ministry also, you've had somebody who shifted from textile to urban to
well, that's also been consistent with the HRD ministers of various parties, but consistently. I mean, you've always had, you know, if you, I mean, what one education advocate has always said to me is, if you want to know something about how good HRD ministers are, look at their constituency to see how HRD is doing, and that gives you a pretty good assessment.
But there is opposite argument, and the people who have expertise end up creating more trouble.
Yes, there is that.
So there is basically you have arguments on both sides. So if a person is just to make judgments, he can hear the arguments, and otherwise you will have to have judge also for telecom, and will have to be like triple PhD only in a particular kind of telecom, not all telecoms, right? So by this logic, you will have nobody doing any administration, right?
Okay,
sorry. Dimesh, we have a question here from Rajesh.
Rajesh, one question. When was the last time any important rules governing the IS were changed? And the related question is, how do rules get changed? I mean, all of the purpose of all of this, I assume, is to see what changes we can make. Are we still working on 1858 rules or like the Police Act, or has there been some modifications?
And Rajesh doesn't drink.
I mean, I think it's fair to say that the basic structure has not changed very much since the outset, right? Which means
wow.
The outset goes back way pre-1947, right? To the beginning of 1858. Yeah. Now, what's happened since then is, I mean, obviously this idea of dual control became deeply ingrained in 47. That was a shift. What you've seen recently is tinkering. So for instance, the Modi government has allegedly, according to news reports, signed off on a policy that would reverse, a few years ago, the previous government changed the eligibility requirements so that you could be much older and continue to take the examination, which many people feel has led to detrimental outcomes. This government apparently has taken a decision to go back to the way things were to get rid of that problem. So that kind of a tinkering sort of takes place, how many times one can take the examination, right? But the sort of larger structural things, I mean, there are blueprints there, right? I mean, we could just pick up the Second Administrative Reforms Commission, right? I mean, there are a million good, literally a million. I mean, there's like, this, you know,
so
12 volumes. But
the question is, under whose domain is it to make these changes? Is it just the cabinet? Or does it have to go through Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, etc.?
Arun Shori had the perfect response for that, right? I agree with you, but who's going to start the file on that? That's exactly what
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
We are just about out of time. A final question? Yes, sir.
My name is Amit. I'm from the NMIMS University. So from HR point of view, I want to understand that you mentioned about the what a late career. So that IS officer who accumulates skills during their tenure. So is there any kind of imperative study which suggests that the IS officers who have kind of gone for skill accumulation, and we have seen a significant increase in their performance post their skill accumulation? Or is it more like the skill accumulation that they have gone through is more of situational or circumstantial, but it hasn't actually led to the kind of significant performance improvement that is expected post their skill accumulation? So
yeah,
is there any empirical longitudinal study which is
the only entry point that these studies give you on that question is whether or not people who have acquired expertise in finance through their early career postings are more likely to receive a posting in finance. And the answer seems to be yes, right? So that does seem to matter. Now, nobody has looked at whether or not then you get better outcomes in what the finance ministry does, which is the crucial question, right? And there, it's a measurement problem, right? I mean, what do you measure, and do we have indicators that we could use, right? So all we know is that the placement of those people ends up being aligned with what they know best, so defense, telecom, so on, but nothing beyond that.
Okay, thank you very much, Dylan. Thank you for the great question. Thanks everyone for a fantastic discussion.